problem we have with the Arctic, it has been misused and abused, like the other bad science, to cause us to do things we don't want to do, to pass legislation that we don't want or need. The polar bears are the best example. People say, well, if the Arctic melts, the polar bears are going to have a problem.
They're going to drown, right?
They're going to drown, yeah. And in fact, a scientist some years ago said he saw four polar bears drown because they couldn't find any ice. Guess what we now know about that story? Almost as good. What we now know is that those polar bears drowned in a storm. But the media didn't report that. What we now know is those kinds of stories have been blown out of proportion. Polar bears are not under any threat. I will tell you now, if you read my book, you will see polar bears are more populous today than they have been in 50 years because of global warming. Look at the data. Polar bears were counted about 10,000 in 1960. They are now easily in the 20, 25,000 range, and by one report, 30,000. And if you go back to Dr. Kaufman's point about the ICUN, the International Conservation Union, their own people will tell you that in 53% of the areas where they monitor polar bears, they really have no idea how many there are, whether they're growing or shrinking. Now, if you 53% of the area and you don't know, and yet somehow you're telling us that they're threatened, and yet their populations are triple what they were before global warming. It's more... lots of bad science out there. Let me go to chapter, or item 14. This is very important. We have been misled, we have been lied to, and it happens every day. There has been no effective growth in the planet's temperature for 13 years. You may quote me on that. And in so doing, you will end up quoting thousands of other scientists around the world who know this, have known it for years. That includes our government. I have made sure that the mainstream media knows this for years. I have made sure our government knows this for years. It is time we stop this lying. Do you agree with me on that? Yes. Question in the back.
This may not be relevant, but I would like for you to answer.
Go ahead, sir.
Our county wants to implement burning landfill gas, methane gas, to generate electricity. And from what I read, ICLEI sponsors and will control the greenhouse emissions. Will their involvement turn this into a liability instead of an asset?
Absolutely. And I have one request of everyone. I need your help. Effective this date, I want you to spread the word, and I want us to set a goal for our country. Every piece of legislation, every politician's speech, every tax dollar that is tied to man-made global warming must be stopped. Must be stopped. This lunacy has got to end quickly, and it's got to end quickly because we're facing a new reality of climate. I'm going to get into that very quickly. And it's something that's here now, something that is not a threat in 2,190 years from now, but is a threat now that we do need to consider, that we do need to take action on. But until we get our politicians, our legislators, our leaders, our financial community to stop this myth of man-made global warming, we're not going to get any change. Thank you. I'll talk more about that at any time, but let me just leave it at that. Do I have your support? Will you help me tell your friends, your family, your politicians? Thank you. and get them my phone number if you need to. A new cold era has begun. In April and May of 2007, I notified the White House, Congress, the mainstream media, as I mentioned before. I also contacted NASA's top solar physicists. NASA has some pretty good guys, pretty bright. I've worked with many of them. But I called their head and I said, "You're wrong." Now here's a guy calling out of the blue, not one scientific paper. Forget my space program background. I'm not a professional climate scientist. I hadn't been to that point for sure. No papers. I didn't teach at a university. No one was quoting me. So out of the blue, he gets a call from John Casey, and John Casey says, "NASA has gotten it wrong. There's a solar hibernation starting. The sun's going to go into a 206-year cycle, and it's going to bring us 30 to 40 years of dangerous cold." Well, I was not well received. But guess what happened in January of this year? NASA has confirmed a solar hibernation has begun. Exactly when I said it would.
Is that why our space program is being folded up?
No. You're getting into my alma mater here. The space program, before President Obama killed the manned space flight program based on the shuttle, and I want to be specific on what he really killed, I had already predicted and announced at a university presentation that we were going to probably see the end of our space program anyway. Not just the manned flight, but most of NASA would disappear. Because at that time, based on my analysis of the government's spending habits, I saw us reaching a point where draconian cutbacks would have to take place by 2019 to save our country. That meant that my love, NASA and the space program, would probably have to be one of those that got cut to save our country. Shortly after that, President Obama did his liberal progressive thing and killed the manned spaceflight program. President Obama is not unlike many of our past presidents. You talk to them about space and their eyes glaze over. They can't relate to it. They miss the beauty of technology. They miss the beauty, the job growth, the leadership globally that comes from challenging our people to do better, to do greater things, to produce better technology. That's what made America great after World War II. The technology boom. We have allowed that to go unfettered. It has kept us the number one country in the world. President Obama's action stabs that in the heart. We have got to put in a president who understands technology and how important it is to the growth and future of our country. Any other questions? Let me go on there. Given the work that the UN has done and others, we now know that they have overestimated the role of CO2 and its sensitivity in our climate by really 8 to 10 times. If you go back to the UN report in 07, you will find out that mankind is 10 to 13 times more influential than the sun is in climate change. Isn't that incredible? How did they get to that? They did so by manipulating the science, by eliminating what is really important in climate change and dwelling on that little 0.12 to 0.28%, depends on what study you look at, that very small piece and blowing it up until it's the biggest piece. If you eliminate the sun, if you eliminate water vapor, then you're down to small percentages of other things that are left. And if that's all you focus on, and you blow them up in proportion, then that's how you get that science manipulated. And that's what happened at the UN. The UN's global climate models, GCMs, have failed utterly, continue to fail every time they're challenged on showing whether they accurately portray the climate. They do not. What does accurately portray the climate and its changes and ability to predict the future climate changes is by following the sun's cycles. Again, it's that simple. I have in my book predicted the next 200 years of climate changes. That's going out on a limb when a lot of scientists will tell you no one can do this. They told me in 2007 I couldn't predict climate change. I did. And I wasn't using bad science to do it. I was using real science. Now, I would very quickly like to get to some charts and show you a lot of the data that I've been using. This one is right out of the UN book. Let me clarify a lot of the myths you've heard on TV and read about. This is somewhat of an eye chart, I apologize. But basically, there are scenarios here portrayed all the way down this chart until you get down to the worst scenario, which basically is we're putting out the maximum amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, and that will result in a sea level rise in the year 2100 or 2099 of 0.26 to 0.59. Yeah, Beatrice. That's not feet.
Centimeters.
Millimeters. Centimeters. Centimeters. This is it, folks. Roughly 2 feet. If the worst case scenario happens, we've got 2 feet of additional water. That's it. Not Al Gore's 20. Not the Orlando Sentinel's flooded Florida, if you remember that coming out, or all the other papers where they show red all over the coastlines. No Miami, no Okeechobee, no Tampa St. Pete.
We can't look forward to Michael Bloomberg kayaking to his to Gracie Mansion in Manhattan?
None of that.
No, that's disappointing.
None of that. This is the UN's final report. Even they acknowledge, forget the big melt. And this assumes worst case scenario, Greenland's melting rapidly, Antarctica's melting away, mountain glaciers have disappeared, the Arctic, which is already melted, which didn't contribute to sea level rise anyway, has already disappeared. This is the worst case scenario, and it's only 2 feet. That's the myth we've been confronting. Yet how often do we see every day in either the newspapers or on TV, by 2050, Florida's going to be flooded. You can't live in half of it. It happens all the time. We still keep seeing people repeat these myths. It's not true. Even the UN, the source of all of this myths and man-made global warming ego, says it's not true. Question, sir.
Point out the 2 feet on that chart, please.
The 2 feet is yes. In the bottom right-hand set of numbers.
It's
26 centimeters to 59 centimeters.
Thank you.
Next chart. I'm going to skip through this quickly because you've already heard the essence of it from Dr. Kaufman and Ruth Esser. Basically, the UN's Agenda 21 waterfalled into the U.S.'s sustainable development projects, waterfalled down into state, county, local, city government planning policies. It's all based on climate change and global warming. We need to educate our leaders. There is no global warming. Stop forcing global warming policies on us. It's that simple. If they want to know where are the facts, have them read my book, give me a call. There are many scientists around the world that will tell you the same things.